Laura Coates, CNN host, senior legal advisor, constitutional expert, author. Laura Coates is a CNN host who specializes in the intersection of civil rights and criminal prosecution. She's a former federal prosecutor. She served as assistant U.S. state attorney for the District of Columbia, as well as a trial attorney in the Civil Rights Division of the Department of Justice, specializing in the enforcement of voting rights, you all, throughout the United States. As a civil rights attorney, she's traveled throughout the United States supervising local and national elections and led investigations into allegations of unconstitutional voting rights practices. In the past, Coates has also served as an intellectual property litigator with expertise in First Amendment and media law. She is the best-selling author of You Have the Right, A Constitutional Guide to Policing the Police. Coates is the host of The Daily Show on Sirius XM, The Laura Coates Show. You probably heard about it. Have you heard it? Do you listen? All right. You have some fans in the room, Laura, which broadcasts live 3 to 6 p.m. Eastern Time on the bipartisan POTUS channel, features her lively analysis of trending news of the day and impactful interviews with entertainers, politicians, D.C. insiders, and game changers like you in this room on topics of politics, pop culture, and everything in between. Everybody, please put your hands together for the tremendous advocate, lady of the hour, or 30 minutes, Laura Coates, everybody. Give it up.
You make me happy. Yes, you can play. You stood right beside me.
Hello. First of all, I don't want to follow Ruby because I can't sing at all. But let me tell you, can I not be behind this? Do you guys mind? Because I feel like no one knows I have legs because I'm always in a box like this. And I cannot tell you how grateful I am and thankful I am to see all of you. I told my daughter, because I left before she got up in the morning. She's 7. I told her the night before, I said, Mommy's going out of town. She said, where are you going to go? I said, I'm going to see my sisters. So I hope you all know when you greet me and I greet you, that's what I think, that I am in a room. Not only I see you brothers too, hello, but I see my sisters as well. So thank you so much for having me. And I have to tell you, just, you know, being raised in a place like Minnesota, living in Washington, D.C., I don't know if you all know this ocean. You probably take it for granted that it's here. You probably do. I know recently that ocean has not been kind, but you take it for granted. But I had an opportunity to just go out there. And I tell you, the water for me has always been magnetic. I am completely drawn in. I'm that person who stands on the shore with my toes in the sand, and I think about how relentless that ocean is. I wonder, as the shells come up, I wonder the last time the shell saw the earth and what it was like at that moment in time. Was it thrown in by somebody centuries ago? Was it reclaimed by somebody days ago? And who are the people in between? The secrets that the ocean has heard, the prayers that it has received, the joys it has seen, the way it probably has laughed at humankind, the way it's been angered at what we have done. And I think about this and I stand in awe so often of what it is and the way that it comes back and forth. It knows when to retreat. It knows when to advance. It's followed and drawn and dictated by the moods. It's unapologetic in the nourishment it provides. It has to work around man-made problems. I'm not talking about the ocean anymore. You know that, right? And if you don't know that, you're in the wrong room at the wrong conference. Because the ocean's a woman. Sorry, it is. And you have to stand in awe in her presence because she knows that she touches everything and is appreciated so little compared to the gravity and what she provides. And she knows that she has to be able to function, and she knows that there is a duality, not a duplicity, but a duality between being strong and tender and giving and being impatient. As you know, the ferocity of the ocean is what you can stand in awe of. How it reminds you to always shift your perspective when you've ever been out on the ocean in a boat and looked around and realized how insignificant you as the individual may be. And it forces you constantly to shift that and balance and think about where you are in the grand scheme of things. And that what you do in one place will travel. And what you give will extend. And what you deny has that same effect. And I stand in awe of it because so many times as the waves crest, it's never crestfallen, right? In all the instances of what it's required to do, it's relentless and it keeps going. And that level of appreciation that's often withheld is what I often find a kindred spirit in. I know you probably do as well when you think about what your individual mandates are. When you think about the role that you play, when you think about what you provide, what you withhold, what you give, what you tolerate, what you refuse to tolerate, you find yourselves constantly balancing when you want to retreat or advance. When you're going to, irrespective of somebody else's timing, show them and wash over the power that you are. And I think about this moment when I think about the ocean, I think about a story that a colleague of mine shared. And it's a story about a man who walks onto an ocean and then walks into the sand. And he sees this child running desperately back and forth and then throwing her arm repeatedly. And he gets closer and tries to figure out what this child is doing. And he looks closer and sees that the entire beach is full of these starfish that have washed up, star after star, to the tune of thousands. It probably was millions, just knowing what the ocean can give. And he's watching this child run and pick up each starfish and throw it as far as she can back into the ocean before the water leaves that starfish behind. And she's going to and fro, and she's here, and she's picking up and throwing and sees again, and she goes over in here. And the man walks down to, you know, pat her on the head with that unique blend of condescension. And let me teach you all that you should know. And he says, "What are you doing?" And she says, I'm throwing him back in. I'm trying to get him back in. Help me, I'm trying to get the, before the waves go, I'm trying to get the tarpers back in. Why don't you help me?" He looks around and says, "Help you? This is an exercise in futility. Do you see there's one of you and there are thousands of starfish that need to go back? What you're doing, you can't save them all. And what you're doing is not going to mean enough to all of them." And she stopped in her tracks with the starfish in her hand and looked at him with such an air of condescension now, because she knew. And she said, "Well, it means something to this one." And she threw it as far as she could. And I share that because there are so many times that what we're dealing with can feel overwhelming when you talk about the umbrella of social justice. Because there's not just one problem to fix. There are thousands of starfish on that sandy beach. Thousands of them waiting to be dealt with, to be given an opportunity, to be recognized as individuals, to be addressed and resolved. And there's always somebody out there to tell you that what you're doing isn't going to change everything right now, but you have to have the strength, the ambition, the resolve, and the integrity to know that it means something to that one. And the one that you deal with might not be your own. This little girl wasn't a starfish. It wasn't as if she didn't have her own issues to deal with. It wasn't as if there wasn't the metaphor of somebody, her wanting somebody to throw her into a place of safety and security. Have we felt like that? But yet and still, the focus was on knowing the power that she had and possessed in that moment and what she herself could do with it. And the naysayers be damned. Because when you talk about social justice issues, you're talking about oftentimes trying to empty the ocean with a ladle. And it feels daunting. And it feels overwhelming. And it is exhausting to feel as though no one's throwing you back in. And when they do, it's boiling water. And you got to figure out a way to get out. And that's really been the story of the role of women, and women of color in particular, in the social justice movements. It's been about waiting for people to acknowledge that it's your turn. It's about waiting for people to understand that, like the ocean, you've retreated strategically, but you will advance with your power after you've had the wherewithal, after you have watched, after you have seen how to avoid and evade man-made problems. And you know, we often talk, I'm somebody who is a constitutional scholar, and I so often, if you see me on where, you know, this last couple years, I mean, the law hasn't really been a big deal in the last couple years. I mean, the Constitution's maybe mentioned once or twice a day. I mean, maybe, but not really, right? I mean, thank you to Lin-Manuel Miranda that the Constitution was mentioned at all, right? And I've had the privilege to be in the room where it happens. Hashtag Aaron Burr. I would sing, but again, Ruby already sang, so I can't. And she sang, so I can't sing. But I gotta tell you, I so often hear, and a little bit of me cringes every time someone talks about these founding fathers. And they have such pride and joy in their eyes about the founding fathers. And you think, wow, the founding fathers. What about the sustaining mothers? Because that's actually who has made the difference. That's actually what it is. You know, there are the people who can plan, and then there are the people who can implement it, execute it, tweak it, revamp it, and make it work for the world. And I have always found that the sustaining mothers, so to speak, are the ones who fill that role, all the while having to be in a position to wait. And you know, I'm an optimist, so there is that, in times you're compelled to feel angered by just the history of America and the history of social justice in the world, and the idea of how women are constantly being told to wait their turn. But you know what has happened in the meantime? In the meantime, while women have been, well, thought to be waiting, because we know we didn't actually wait to start anything, but while they were thought to be waiting, we were watching, we were studying, we were learning about the ways in which all the arguments that would be presented towards us could be combated. How many lawyers are in this room? It's okay, you can admit it. We're friends. Okay, it's all right. People are like, I don't know. I'm not gonna make fun of us because I'm one. But you know, we have a way of locking you into an answer, right? You know, cross-examination, I joke around how cross-examination at trial is that moment in time when, you know, you get to really show your chops as a prosecutor, as an attorney. Because it doesn't really matter what their response is. It only matters what you're saying. If you don't know what I'm talking about, you know what direct is kind of like, so where were you? Who were you with? What time was it? What was the weather like? And across is that angry woman who looking at you like, I called you four times, you didn't answer your phone. You were with so-and-so. It was dark outside, it was raining. Your headlights weren't on. You know, the whole thing is going down, right? Lawyers are laughing because you know. Doesn't matter what you say, I'm telling the story on the terms, and you can feel free to nod along or whatever you want, but the story will be out there. And when you think about this and the way that lawyers have a way of locking you in, or as an athlete trying to commit you to one side before you go the other way and do your layup, that's what it's been like as we have watched, advanced, retreated, reconvened, progressed. Because every single dispute, every single social justice issue, whether it's about equality in terms of voting rights, whether it's about police brutality, whether it's been about what's going on in Afghanistan and the role of women and girls in the changing environment, or for Texas, and the idea of women no longer having agency over their bodies, but I haven't seen a man legislate a vasectomy. I don't remember that being on the books. I really don't. Now the men are like, dessert? check, please. When you see these happening, when you have the reminders and the hashtag legacy of so many people, to have to be reminded to say her name. When a nation reels and is devastated and reacts, before they even do a video we've seen of the death of George Floyd, before you even know who Breonna Taylor was, you know the order of things in our world. Inadvertent, intentional, it doesn't matter. The order is often set. But I mentioned the locking somebody into an answer because what you see when women in the role in social justice, when through the course of history we have participated in and led and reacted to various movements, we know that ultimately it impacts us all. That the one starfish you throw back is the one that has an impact on what you are doing, asking for, demanding, requiring. When you fight for human rights, are you not a human? When you fight for the role of women being able to vote, didn't it include the notions of equality and representative government? And by the way, that phrase, "a republic if you can keep it," was stolen from a woman, but you don't know that. When you think about the ways in which we look and fight for what's going on for women across the globe, we know that domestically, the water comes back. And what we must do. And when the arguments we've had in the past have been presented, it's like that whack-a-mole. Someone says, you say this argument, they pop it down. This one, they pop it down. So by the time it gets to the most important, perhaps selfish one for you, and that's not a bad word, they've exhausted all of the answers that prevent the change from coming. And you have locked in what you know as precedent to then say, well, if that's the case, then why not for me? If you believe in this, if you believe that women and girls should be empowered in another nation, then you obviously mean it here. If you believe, for example, in the case of what's going on in Texas, and you believe, according to that legislation, that at 6 weeks, it should be considered a legal child, well, then surely your legislative laws will reflect the support for those children. Certainly you can't deport a woman who has a child now at 6 weeks, right? Certainly child support must be due at 6 weeks. And I'll say it again, you can't deport a woman then who has a 6-week-old child within her womb. See how the consistency must be locked in. So while the Supreme Court looks at precedent and does what it's going to do with respect to, sorry, should I use air quotes, precedent now. Women in social justice set it on the ground day to day. When you're talking about the ideas of, say, the Fourth Amendment and the unreasonable search and seizure of somebody moseying along in their car, confronted by an officer, well then surely you have the same viewpoints as it relates to the audacity of a government, they say, to have a say in what gets put into your body. Views about vaccination. Surely you have that same view about Elijah McClain, who was walking home from a store and injected with ketamine. Because you have a problem with what's actually injected, right? No? Is that different? Is that a different conversation? Because I thought that fundamentally the premise was X. And I've locked you in to an answer societally. I've locked you in legislatively. You've locked it in through your policy statements. You've locked it in through what you've said. So now it must apply when the ocean advances again. I've retreated again as we've watched. And you've told me about how you don't want anyone to commit fraud in an election. So let me walk back a little bit. Let the sand be visible. I'm not gonna fall off the stage. You're not gonna have me falling off page on live TV. You're like this. Well then, surely when someone does something in the electoral realm that's based on a lie, here I am again, knocking on the door to remind you of the precedent you've set. Waiting your turn, stealthily retreating to advance once again. And see, it takes people who are going to be in each of your positions on a daily basis, not just people who are visible on television, audible on a radio, on Capitol Hill with a cute button to tell you that they're a member of Congress, have a good presidential seal in front of them, or a book to write. It takes people every day creating the precedent and reminding of the precedent and reminding about what the path has been like in all fields to remind the nation of when you say this is not who we are, then let us not be. And you see women, again, in that duality, that equal blend of strength and tender and focus and empathy, all the things that people speak of as feminine qualities. You should add to that irritated, impatient, intelligent, frustrated, exhausted, or as I went to that panel earlier today, overwhelmed. And you should know that in the quest and in the path for all of these things, it doesn't mean that in recognizing the power that you have in precedent setting, it doesn't mean that you don't get to be exhausted along the way. It doesn't mean that somehow, because somebody has defined you as strong, it means that you can never demonstrate a weakness. Or that we should, as women, suddenly decide to strive to be what is defined as a man. I've never wanted to be a man. Never been part of my bucket list of things to do. Not a day, not a second, not a moment. I have always wanted to be a woman and recognized as what that means for my strength, for my weakness, for my joy, for my pain, for my advancement, for my retreat, for my collective memory. And as we battle for the soul of the nation, I hope women become its soul. Because it's required to have that duality of focus and the ability to have that changing perspective to remind the individual how insignificant and the collective how strong. That's what it's about, navigating around the so-called man-made problems. I mean human at that point. And I think about this often in terms of a quote that I just love, and it's written on my wall and my kids can articulate it. Probably easier they can recite Dr. Seuss. Is he safe to talk about yet? I think so. I didn't watch the news today, so I'm not sure if I just hit a grenade all of a sudden. But the quote is, and this is, my kids know it more, and it's a quote by Arthur Ashe. And it is, start where you are, use what you have, do what you can. Start where you are, use what you have, do what you can. And I bet in each of your lives and in each strive towards accessing and realizing the umbrella that is vast of social justice, you might not realize that every day there's an opportunity for you to do that. Maybe not recognize on the grand scale, but as important as the starfish that's thrown back. And I tell you, there was a story out of Nashville just last week. And I read it and it brought tears to my eyes. Let me stop playing. I was dripping with tears. You may not know, I'm a crier. I'm very emotional. Thank God the camera pans away so you don't see my eyes rolling. Because it's there. So I'd be like, oh, really? Oh, that's a great point. I'd be happy to explain. You're wrong. I'm not going to argue. I'm just going to tell you why you're wrong and I'm right. But I'm not going to argue about it. Oh, I have 46 seconds to explain the Constitution? Sure, sure. Sounds great. But I tell you, I was crying profusely because I'm in touch with my emotions and they're always below the surface. I'm okay with that. My kids know, oh, mommy's crying again. I don't care. That's what I do. You will not have my cup runneth over on my watch. I got to drain some stuff and go. To me, to deal with what we deal with, I've got to release some things. There are many a day where I'll turn on a sad movie just to cry, just to be like, this is going to be a hard week. Where is Terms of Endearment? Give my daughter the medicine! That's my scene. I'll just be crying. My parents are like, what is wrong with you? And I'm like, no, what's right with me? Okay? Because you're going to overflow and I'm going to be spelt in my emotions. Although I am one roll away in this pandemic suit from this popping off. So if there's dessert, save my cheesecake. I'll be done talking. Don't touch it. I'm coming back to it. And this shirt may be unbloused and I may have it down here. And you know what? I'm okay with that. And this is a little long enough I can be like, oh no, my stomach's not poking out. What are you talking about? Picture time. Wonderful. But this quote that made me bawl thinking about the Arthur Ashe quote was, a woman out of Nashville, a sister, working two jobs, and it was getting time for school to start. She has two kids, a little boy, a little girl. A little girl loves to get her hair done. And we know how it feels to get your hair done in the style that you want. Whatever your style of choice is, the confidence of knowing that what you will present to the world matches how you feel about yourself. Whatever that looks like. And she saw her little girl and the joy when she would braid her daughter's hair. Two jobs. Didn't have a lot of money. Was trying to make ends meet. And the string was just too short to do it. You know what that's like. You know what she did? She put a posting on Facebook. And she said, hey, I'm in the Nashville area. I braid hair. Anyone need their daughter's hair braided before school, I'll do it for free. That's it. Do you know what the posting received? She said, had so many people respond, of parents saying, thank you, I really do need help. I cannot afford it. But I want my daughter, for the first time when they go back after, if you're like my children, who didn't set foot into a school building from March of 2020 to August of 2021. My daughter left during the pandemic as a kindergartner, came back as a second grader. But you know how long that is. And why, if I were to part my hair, you would see the gray. Oh my God, Jesus. You know. God bless my children. But I'm gonna send a bill to whoever has kept COVID going. Send a bill. Say, here's a bill. Thank you. Here's my stress. Thank you so much. But I kept my kids healthy and happy, thank God. And I know, but for the grace of God, go I. But I can tell you, when she sent that Facebook posting out, so many people responded singing her praises and signed up. It started out with 35 girls. And you know how long it takes to braid hair and get the hair washed and blow dried and do what you got to do to get everything ready and coordinate everything that needs to happen to make the style last. So then she reached out again to people and said, Facebook posting number two. Anyone else can maybe help me donate some brushes, or maybe if you have some time to help me, I'd appreciate it. It got so much responses from people who were willing to help, to start where you are, use what you have, do what you can, that she has to have a building rented out now. A building rented out. And she'll do it every single month. Now, some people would look at this and on the grand scheme of things say to themselves, well, that doesn't change voting rights in America. It hasn't changed the way that police interactions occur. It's not big enough to be thought of as a social justice issue. But let me tell those naysayers, the same ones who will look and say, little girl, why do you bother to throw the starfish back into the ocean because it means something to that one? Let me tell you what she knew at the intersection and where she stood as a woman, as an ocean. She knew that the reason those parents did not have the money is because of the economic downturn in the she session. She knew that the idea of children in school and young black girls going to school and the way they are treated as adults as opposed to the youth that they are, the rates of suspensions, the treatment, the assumption that they are women, the way in which they're disciplined, the way they are ignored, the way they are dismissed, that you don't need to walk out of your door with the weight of the world if somebody can do one thing to help your spine be straight, because you're gonna need it today and tomorrow. And you had to have a style that would last. And I'm not just talking about the hair, a style, a mantra that would last. And that somebody else cared enough about you in that moment to know that you were worth the pickup, the throwback, and the turn to the man to say, you don't know what I know. That is social justice. Because she's now prepared her, that little girl, to do whatever she is destined to do, because someone was in a position to take away a roadblock and a hurdle. And that is what justice is. And don't take for granted for a second that you have the power to start where you are, use what you have, and do what you can. Whether you are in corporate America, whether you're on the front line of whatever proverbial war you live in and try to exist and thrive in, you have the tools to throw something back into the ocean. Not to throw it away, but to help. To help in that moment. To be something to somebody. My father always said to me, he still does, all the time, because I call him 10 times a day, and my mom too. You know, I'm that daughter, I'm that child. Don't think if you have a grown child that she's not gonna call. I'm that, my karma is set. My kids, my God, I'm telling you, set. To this day, I'm like, it's 4 a.m., I'm up. What's up? Laura, what's wrong? Oh, I can't sleep. What are you doing? I was sleeping. Oh, I can't. Anyway, so blah, 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 blah. That's me. My husband says the same thing he says to me all the time. I say, if we could sum up our marriage in just a few lines, he jokes around and says, Laura would say, wake up, I can't sleep. It's true. It's true. But he knew what he was getting into. I've always been the same way. He knew. Because my father says to me, everybody was somebody's star once. Everybody was somebody's star once. And still should be, I've added on. And I tell you, it comes back full circle even today. And I know that she didn't realize she was doing it. I'm looking for her. Her name is Tracy. She's going to be on the big panel right after this. There she is in the back. I'm talking about you, Tracy. Hello. She's like, what? What did I do? I'll tell you what you did. Earlier today, I had the pleasure of meeting so many of you. I was standing in the hallway. And I was so happy to see my sisters. I was so happy to see you and your teeth. Like, hello, lower face. Hi, so nice. And I didn't even say a word. I just looked in a direction that I wanted to go. And it was towards coffee, I'll admit that. I looked over, and before I could say a thing, a sister said, how you want your coffee? And I, of course, thought, oh, no one's going to get my coffee. I'm not that person. I'll get my own coffee. I'll get my own coffee. She says, no, I'll do it. I don't know where she was going or what she was doing next, but what she did through the communication of eyes was saw a starfish wanting to be thrown into the ocean. And it's a little thing, and I saw it, sis. I did. And it was great coffee. Delicious. Because it was free. And I'm very cheap. My husband's like, really? Yes, wherever he is. But I say that to tell you just full circle of what the daily acts of kindness and joy and what you can do. And if you need, I always wonder, when I'm doing radio or doing TV, I'm talking to a camera 99% of the time. 75% I have on sweatpants, but 99% of the time, 99% of the time, I've got, you think I'm kidding. I'm like, no. I'm thinking John McEnroe. I'm like, the professional mullet, professional on top, but I can go anywhere on the bottom. But I think to myself about, I'm sitting in a room so often, wondering who can hear and wondering who I'm speaking to and who needs to receive or hear. And so I don't know who you are today and what you need to hear or how you receive. But if your quest is social justice, know that your quest really is to recognize the intersection of where you are standing, that you are the connective tissue like the ocean, thinking about at some point in time, the wave is going to have to come in. Is it going to crash over you, or is it going to provide? And it may not be your child who's at the end of the hashtag. You may have a way to the polls. You may be somebody with housing security or money coming into your account. But it doesn't mean that you get to stand stagnant. It doesn't mean that because your waters are calm, you stop. You have to be like what we see across the street and continue nonetheless. Because somebody else's dreams are on that ocean, and they're waiting for that shell to roll its way up to you, and for you to realize in that moment, somebody needed me to see this. Somebody needed me to do something. And you've got to look for those opportunities to start where you are, to use what you have, to do what you can. And in the end, it's not about waiting. It's not about being angered when someone overlooks you. It's not about being overly joyful because someone actually recognized you either, because they were supposed to. They were supposed to. But it is about continuing and being unyielding and relentless nonetheless, and continuing and figuring out how far you can really stretch and go, and where you will retreat, where you will advance, and where, under pressure, under extreme conditions, you will surprise the seaboard with what you can do. And you'll do it unapologetically, and you'll navigate and stay the course. And I really hope you know how proud I am to see all of you here today, how I'm proud of everything that you're doing. I recognize that I may be visible, but I know who you are, and I see you. And I see the daily tasks. I see the daily inches that you move. I see that the ladling of the ocean that you try to remove. And we have to make that sort of hypothetical eye contact and see where our sisters need to go. And if you're closer, you get it to them. So I want to thank you all. I love the panels that I've seen so far. I can't wait to meet more of you, my sisters, to see you as my friends, to know that you're not alone, to know, like our singer, to be a bridge over troubled water, or sometimes to be next to you while we trouble that water and make sure our power is felt. Thank you.